So we will continue with our, we had started how to find out stresses. I mean, this was our stresses, bending stresses. I mean, I will not say just stresses. In beams, and the beams also have qualified. So stresses due to bending, you can say deformation of beams, and then the beams have qualified that beams have got vertical plane of symmetry. Isn't it? They have got vertical, that means I have taken the cross section of beam something like this, it's dumbbell shaped, which has got vertical plane of symmetry. Vertical plane means this vertical, what is this axis? This is Z axis and this is G centroid, and then this is Y axis. X is like this, coming out of the plane of the X, Y and Z. So this is the cross section. So this half is mirror image of the other. So whatever we are developing will be valid for such cross sections. Idea is that we do not want, we are applying loads, you know, first of all we have applied bending moment. First of all, I have taken a very simple problem. First we are saying only at every cross section only pure bending moment is acting, no shear force. Because at any cross section you can have axial force, you can have bending moment, you can have shear force, three. So only bending moment, pure bending moment. So it is a due to pure bending, stresses due to pure, this word is there, pure. So we have taken, now you will say that I should not repeat this, but then repetition is necessary. So due to pure bending, so like this, no variation of bending moment, because if I say here M1 and here M2, so there will be change in bending moment from cross section to cross section, and therefore rate of change of bending moment gives you a shear force, dm by dx equal to, we got a shear, there is a relationship. So it is a pure bending moment at any cross section. So every element of the beam is subjected, sorry, this one is like this, this is correct, M. And then, and that day, yes, we started with, of course, slender beam, I think we have made the assumption. And for pure bending, it so happens that this slender beam assumption is truly not necessary, because there are no shear stresses here. And because of shear stress is not there, shear strain will be zero, because shear stress is related to shear strain through G, and that is what Namrata had that day raised, and it was very right. But then in general, because beam is not going to be subjected to pure bending moment, there will also be, you know, next we will just go to when it is subjected to both bending and shear at any cross section, that means if there is a general load, then what happens? So you have to have a slender beam, you have to have the transverse normals must remain straight and normal to the what? Normal to the neutral axis. I think we got also a neutral axis, concept of neutral axis, axis which does not undergo any change in length, longitudinal axis, because this is the depth. If this is the depth, it can be thought of as having so many fibers, so many layers, and when it is subjected to moment, so there will be some will undergo change, I mean extension, bottom one will go compression, and in between there will be some fibers which will undergo no change. So that axis, or that layer, or that location, we call that axis as neutral axis. So our x-axis is coincident with neutral axis. Normally what happens, x-axis will be coincident with neutral axis. We'll later on prove that neutral axis is turned out to be centroidal axis. It must pass through centroid, that we'll prove. Okay, so we had studied deformation, because in study of any problem you have got three steps. What is first one is study of deformation. And what does this give? Deformation means how does points within the beam or any member move when the loads are applied. And then we had given some consideration of symmetry, non-symmetry, and then we said, okay, transverse, this normal, transverse normal means this, if you take this cross section, this is the trace of the cross section, this is the line. This normal will remain straight and normal to the neutral axis all the time during deformation. Okay, this. Incidentally, there was an interview, and when we asked which normal or which, because people just remember it is given in the book, especially some Indian book written by Vajirani, Ratwani and things like that. So they have written plane sections remain plane before and after bending. So most of the students just remember this by heart, plane section, because it comes in the examination. Write down the assumptions involved in theory of beams. Plane sections remain plane before and after bending. Now which plane section they don't know, because you can have this plane section, you can have this vertical plane section, you can have horizontal plane section. There are so many plane sections. So when you ask them which plane section, they get confused. Many of the people senior level, they say this horizontal plane section. I'm like, a horizontal plane section that bends, my dear friend, that will bend like this. How can this remain plane? This is bending. X-axis is going to bend. So they will say this plane section. So it is very important, it is perpendicular to this plane. So this is a normal which is up, and this normal will always remain like this. In all, this will always be maintained. Normality will always be, so this we are assuming. And then we had said there is a physical meaning to this, that shear stress. So one is, I will just quickly, one is H by L less than unity. Two, so it is, that leads to gamma xz equal to 0. Third one, we are saying what is this thickness of the beam. This thickness of the beam does not undergo any change. What leads to thickness change? If you take two points in the vertical in the z direction, so there should not be any change in, so epsilon z is 0. Is it not? Epsilon z is the cause in which will lead to changes in. So third one we say epsilon z is 0 exactly. And then the fourth one also we have made an assumption, and that I told you is not exact, it is approximate, and that is what? Sigma z is approximately, so never write equal to, is approximately 0. I will explain why it is said. Why do you say that? Because normally, first of all, this is top is free, bottom is free, bending moment is applied. So here sigma z is 0. Sigma z is vertical. So there is no load. So sigma z is 0. So as you come down, here also it is 0. It is free surface, bottom. Sigma z is 0. Okay, free surface means there is no, if you take a small element, this z is 0. Top surface is free, there is no normal stress unless you have applied a load. So, and this depth is very, very small, this thickness is small, it is a slender beam. So how much it will change? 0 to 0, some. So we are saying it is a very, very small quantity compared to other stresses, and therefore it will be neglected. Later on I will show you. So these are the four assumptions that you must remember, and so this we got it from the. And then finally we said if you take a small element dx and neutral axis is having length dx originally, top one also is having dx, bottom also is having dx, so all the fibers are having dx length. Now if it bends, then the top fibers will undergo a change, and that we got that, I think we have derived what is the epsilon, sorry, not epsilon z, what? Epsilon x, strain in x direction, because this is x direction, this direction is x. So if you take two points here at a distance z from the neutral axis, what happens to these two points? These two points will elongate. So what is the change that we have found out? Change in length per unit length, and we got how much? This was equal to z by r. R is the radius of curvature at that instantaneous, because this will bend and this will, yes, it will become something like this. So this is neutral axis, which has, and this one is your a fiber at a distance z. So this distance is z and this one is r. So r plus z is the distance, so z by r is the strain in this fiber longitudinally. So we had stopped here, this was the place where we stopped, I think, yes. So this gave us, I think we have, now we have got all the, so we have got these anyway, in assumption these are 0, epsilon, so there is one strain, epsilon x, which is non-zero and which is positive at a distance z from the neutral axis, of course upwards, it will be negative downwards, is it not? Why it will be negative? Because it will contract. So upwards it is positive, this is z positive, so it is positive. So we have got one. Now how many, so this is lecture number, so this was just the revision, yes, what is the lecture number? 23, okay, yes, 23rd, all right. So this is 23rd. Not September, October. So why didn't you tell me? Okay, so this is, now. So I think deformation one, we have studied deformation fairly. Now just to recapitulate and see how many, at any point how many strain quantities exist in general in three dimension. You have three normal, see, go from fundamental always, then three normal strains and three shear strains at any point. Six stress components, six stresses, so it is, so six. So out of this, in this beam, which is a special beam, I mean we have chosen this to be, which are the things which are there, which are present? So this one is present. Epsilon y, we are not considering, we are considering only the beam in a, you know, cross section of the beam in xz plane. Why we are not considering? We are saying that beam is very narrow, so this one we are not considering. So this is And what about epsilon z? Epsilon z, we have assumed this to be thickness does not change of the beam, so this is also 0. What about xy, x and y? X and y will always remain 90 degrees. X and y axis, the angle will always remain 90 degrees throughout the deformation, because y direction is perpendicular to, so this is 0. xz we have assumed to be, I mean, of course, in this case it is exactly, because there is no shear stress and therefore shear strain, pure bending, so this is also, this we have, because of the, and yz, between y and z, y direction and z, x is this, y is perpendicular to the plane of the beam and z is like this, that also will always remain 90 degrees throughout, because beam you are considering as if it is, there is no twisting, it does not twist, this axis, y axis always remains horizontal, so this is also. So only two quantity, I mean this one is non-zero, only one is non-zero, all are out of this. Now let us go to the next step, two. Second step is, in any study, is stress strain relation. If there is a this strain, we have taken this fiber at a distance z of thickness dz. So this one is at a distance z here, and this thickness is okay. Everybody is with me. I mean, this is okay. This is so. When bending moments are applied, of course this will bend and this will elongate, the distance between two points will change, and that we have already found out, yeah, strain is created, epsilon x gets created. Now stress strain relation, it relates, what are the relations between stress and strain, stresses to strain. Yes. There is a Hooke's law, general Hooke's law, everywhere, you know. What are the, this should be by, you should know by heart. Three dimensional, you should know by heart. If it is isotropic material, there is no reason why you should not know. We have got this, that this is equal to this is very easy to write. This is very easy to write, but the other way is not. See, I am not making any, I am going from first principle. So there is no, you are not jumping from, so this is the relationship, and the other relationship is gamma xy is tau xy by g. This is for isotropic material, gamma xz is tau xz and gamma yz is tau yz by. Don't use shortcuts, go from first principle. So here we have, this is our general Hooke's law at any point, but it is a simple, this problem is a simple one. There are so many things which are not there. So first of all, here in a beam, remember, beam, when we are talking of beam, it is implied, anybody has got a ruler? Ruler, 12 inches, I mean sorry, yes, 12 inch ka ruler, okay, 6 inch will do. This is the ruler. So this thickness, let us say this is the depth of the beam and this is the thick, it is very thin. You know, perpendicular, that in y direction it is very thin, you know, we are, and depth is this much and this is the length of the beam. So beam looks like this. Loads are all applied in the plane of symmetry so that this does not twist. It remains always vertical, it remains, so this will bend like this, okay. So if the loads are all applied in the same plane and this is very thin, beam is considered to be a thin. The width B is very, very small. So remember this, this is 2. Because this may not be there in the book, but you should. So any member, so I am now not considering the thickness of the beam. Thickness is very, it is a sheet of paper, this thickness is very small compared to, and loads are all, bending moment is applied here only. After all, bending moment must have been applied through some, by applying some couple. So bending moment is applied in the plane of symmetry. So if the loads are applied in the same plane, so loads, moment in XZ plane to Y dimension is very small. That means thin, narrow, it is also called narrow beam, NARROW. We are developing theory for a narrow beam, narrow. Loads are all applied. So then if I take a point here in this plane of the beam, at a point, what is the stress that are acting at any general point? In general point, what is the coordinate of a general point? X and Z. Because Y is not there, Y thickness is very small. So it is in the same plane. So X and Z. So general point P, the coordinate is X and Z. So general point P, X, Z. You find jo hai aapka, gadbad hai. Okay, this is starts moving and it's okay. So then such a problem, there is no load in the y direction. No load perpendicular to the plane XZ, that means in y direction. So this is a special loading structure, everything is special. So what happens? So here in this case, out of the 6 stress quantities, sigma x, sigma y, sigma z, tau xy, tau xz, tau yz. I think you understand all this, not? So which one will be present? Which one will be non-zero? Yes, you can have this. You can have this in general. Sorry, not this. No, there is no load in y direction. So this has to be zero. This is possible. X and y direction is this. Inside the plane of the paper, xy will always be 90 degrees throughout. Xy at any instant of time, during loading, before loading, after loading, it will always be 90 degrees. So this one will be zero all the time. xz, yes, xz means this one, between this and this. Yes, in this case it so happens, that is a different matter, but yes, there can be a change in this xz. Two element if you take, so this can be there. What about yz? Y is this and z is this. That again will always be 90 degree. So you are left with only three quantities. So left with only three stresses. This is very important, which are non-zero. See, don't think that this is a high stuff and this is not even in the book, so you will not understand. This can be understood by anybody. So this is only three stresses. What are the stresses which are non-zero? Sigma x, sigma z, and tau xz. These are the only which are non-zero. Is it? Do you agree? That means if I take this point P here, I bring this point P here, I make a small element around point P. How do you show stress at any point? You create a small element, a square element. This is point P. So you can have sigma x, you can have sigma z, then this xz is this. On this it will be, do you understand why it will be like this? On this plane, this will be, one is xz, other one is yz also. And do you know that they are equal? But tau xz is equal to tau, not yz, zx. One is xz, other one is zx. Why zx? Because this plane is z in x direction, zx. So state of stress at any point within the beam is given by this diagram. This is called state of stress. That means stresses acting at any general point within the beam, at any general point, will be defined by these three stress components, and they will look like this. On a small element, you have to show like this. Is it okay? Have you understood? Now such, this you have drawn on a simple plane of the paper. This you have gone, there are no stresses perpendicular to the plane. What is important here is, there is no stress perpendicular. What is the plane perpendicular to this plane? Y. Y. What are the stresses in Y? On this plane, Y. Sigma Y, tau YZ, and tau YX. Tau YX and tau Y. So both are zero. So there are no stresses on a plane perpendicular to this xz plane. Is it clear or not? No stress on this, a free surface. This plane is y plane. There are no stresses. It is free. It is free. No stress on this plane back and front. where are the stresses? Stresses are on this and on this. Okay. So perpendicular to the plane, there are no stress. So this state of stress, which is designated or defined by three stress components, sigma x, sigma z, and tau xz, it is called state of plane stress. Plane stress. See, if you have all the six components, then it is a three-dimensional state of stress. This is a called plane stress state. Plane stress, P-L-A-N-E. I think I have told you. Yes, so this is plane stress. I am again reinforcing. So this is a called plane stress. So beam, your beam is in a state of plane stress. It becomes further simpler, but basic thing is it is in a state of your real problem is a plane stress problem. So you have got only these three stress components which are non-zero. So now if you make that zero from the Hooke's law which you have written here, make all the stresses zero. So which are the stresses which are zero? Sigma y is zero. Everywhere sigma y is zero. Then what else is zero? Tau xy is zero and tau this one. So I will be making use of this and let us see here what happens to the Hooke's law. So my Hooke's law, so we have to use, you have to use a simplified Hooke's law. Is it clear? Instead of general three dimensional, you have to use simplified, and we will call it Hooke's law for, see, go step by step. Don't say I am slow. Okay, Hooke's law for yes. See, the one which we had written was for a general three-dimensional state of stress. Now we are writing plane stress. Incidentally, plane stress also is called, it is a two-dimensional state of stress, because now we are referring things only in two dimension. Why two dimension? You are needing only two coordinates, x and z. So it is a two-dimensional, it is 2D state of stress. So these, all these phrases, terms are, they have a relation from one another. So you should understand, 2D means two-dimensional, not three-dimensional. 3D means three-dimensional, 2D, 1D means one-dimensional. So 2D is state of stress. So what will be the state of stress for Hooke's law? First one will become epsilon x equal to 1 by E minus nu, very simple. Here, this is epsilon y, actually 1 by E nahi, it has been just rewritten. What about third one? And one more, gamma xz yes, so this is our simple three. Do you agree this is okay? So this is, but then this is two dimensional. Everything is there because x and z. Beam theory, my aim is, in a beam theory, my aim is to develop a one dimensional beam theory. That means I can solve this problem as it is, as a two dimensional problem. But then this is beyond the scope of your first course. Yes, you can solve this, because then this is, you have to deal with xz. Xz means variation quantity, p is a function of xz. So you will get partial differential equation, change in x as well as change in z. So any quantity will change with respect to two coordinates, that means you will get a partial differential equation. And as you know, partial differential equation is more difficult than ordinary differential equation. So our aim here is not to study this two-dimensional problem as such, because this will give me a mathematical model that will be complex. I want to develop a simple mathematical model based upon whatever assumptions that I have made earlier. Based on the assumptions that I have, yes, that this is okay, you can use this, then you need not have any assumption. It is a general two-dimensional problem, because this state of stress is valid for any general beam, irrespective of their thickness. It need not be slender. It need not be slender. But now, so we will bring in now other things. Yes. So in our case, so this will give you, so actually I will just write here. Actually, beam in plane stress is a two-dimensional problem. Or 2D. See, whenever you want to define any shot, it is called acronym. Two-dimensional. So we write within bracket first time you write full two-dimensional, then within bracket you define this 2D. Later on you can use in your write-up just 2D. Instead of writing every time two-dimensional, it is not necessary. One time in your text you should write two-dimensional and define like this. So plane stress is a two-dimensional problem. Okay. Yes, I will give you, just let me just complete this. You can go. If you want to go, Khatri, to submit, you can go. So this is a two-dimensional problem. So, and two-dimensional means PD. This will lead to, what is PD? What is the meaning of PD? Partial differential equations. Two-dimensional, it will lead to two-dimensional partial differential equation. You have done partial differential equation from Kreisky book, I believe. You should have done. No mathematics, no partial differential equation so far. PDE, partial differential equation. How to solve, how to solve a Laplace equation, d square phi by dx square plus d second derivative of phi with respect to y square equal to 0, which is called del square phi equal to 0, Laplace equation. Do you know how to solve Laplace equation? It is a partial differential equation in two dimension. You can also have in three dimension, but, So partial differential equation, so it is a lead to 2D PDE. Difficult. To start with. So we would like to see whether we can have a simpler model. 5. Okay. So we have noted here that this leads to, this is a two-dimensional Hooke's law. And this will lead to solution of problem as two-dimensional problem, and that is actually a two-dimensional plane stress problem. It will be a partial differential equation, and it will be not easy to solve. Of course, you can always solve, but then, so we are trying to develop. So this one, now how to, so now let us see our assumptions. Yes, why did we make assumption of slender beam? We have made assumption of slender beam. So this one here, and I will simplify here. So now invoke Bernoulli-Euler assumptions. Those are called Bernoulli-Euler assumptions based upon, I mean, the whole. And there was one more name I had given you. What is that name? Kirchhoff hypothesis. So Kirchhoff hypothesis is this. This is x-axis, and this is your normal perpendicular to this, and this is the thickness. This angle 90. Afterwards, this x-axis will become slightly inclined. Once it gets deformed, then it becomes like this. This angle will be still 90 degrees, always. So between x and z, this angle will always be. So this is called Kirchhoff hypothesis. This one is Kirchhoff. This is known as Kirchhoff hypothesis. And this is, this, the physical meaning of this is that gamma xz is 0. Shear strain, there is no shear strain in vertical plane, you know, vertical xz plane. Yes, xz plane. Okay, angle is always maintained. Xz axis is always maintained at 90 degrees. This one is z axis. Okay, so this one, now I will say epsilon x. So I told you, in the beginning, I have made an assumption that sigma z is very, very small compared to, because physics of the problem is such that load in z, sigma z will not be there. It's a small quantity compared to sigma x and other. So since sigma z is less than we can have, therefore, epsilon x from here, two-dimensional. This is a two-dimensional. So don't try to, we are from here, this one. So this one is gone. So you will get 1 by E sigma x. So should this equal sign remain there? Approximately, yes. This will, should become approximate, actually. Although you are using, say, the moment you have, you introduce assumption in a theory, the things become approximate. There will be some error. It is not exact, this one, but then this is, we take this. Now, this one, Second one. Very simple. Third one, this itself we are saying epsilon z itself is 0 in our case, beam. We are saying, let us assume it is a slender beam, thickness does not undergo any change, yes. Epsilon y should go? No, pure bending, otherwise also epsilon y is 0 all the time. Anyway, sorry, epsilon y will not, this one, see, if you have epsilon x, then the perpendicular direction gets affected. If I stretch in x direction, y direction and z direction, they will reduce. If I compress x direction, then y direction and z direction will increase slightly. What is that increase or reduction? Is new times. So it is a new time. So it is, this is okay. Okay, so this is that effect. But this is not something new. If you know this, so this is a dependent relationship. This is you need to know only sigma x, then epsilon y also can be found out. So this we, and the last one is here we are saying. What we are saying? This is very funny. See, assumption has made the whole equation. On one side, we are saying this one is very, very small. We are saying this quantity is small in this relationship. And then we are also saying that epsilon z is 0. So that will make sigma x equal to 0. No. Sigma x is 0, there is no need for any theory. Beam will not bend. So this leads to contradiction. If you use this third equation, then this will. So sometimes invoking an assumption gives rise to some contradictions. So this one will lead to, that means third one, epsilon z. This. So this leads to contradiction. So best thing is, don't use this. Therefore, don't use this expression at all. Don't use this relation at all. That will solve. So please do not use this. So basically we are left only with one, and plus one more. One more is what? What is that? What is the one more? This is okay. Nothing is there. So yes. Plus you have gamma xz. So you are left with, so in the beam theory, therefore, see, these are the steps. therefore next, no, we cannot use this and. This is also very funny. This, you have something to say? There is some problem. Because if you consider the other one, it will lead to complication, and this cannot be used because this is give you a erroneous result. This one, particular for epsilon z in the vertical direction, in the z direction, yes, change in length per unit length, yes. Yes. We are assumed that. We are saying the thickness of the beam, we are saying in the beam theory, because it is slender, let us assume, and because why we are doing all this, we want to develop a simpler theory. I do not want to solve this as a two-dimensional problem. So I am developing a simpler theory. So I am saying thickness, what is this thickness? Thickness will change by some micro millimeter, something. So let us assume this to be zero. So that means if it is zero, so therefore epsilon z has to be zero. So I cannot use this relation because this will give me very funny relationship. It says that sigma x equal to zero. So I cannot use this. This leads to contradiction. So I don't use this. I will use the first one. Epsilon z is not the only strain. Epsilon z is not the only strain. You also have epsilon x. You also have epsilon x. So we are, epsilon x is a major strain. But epsilon z is a very, very minor, very small quantity, which we are assuming to be zero in the theory. Okay. There is nothing wrong. Epsilon x longitudinal strain is a major quantity that we are assuming. Get it right? So there is nothing wrong. We have assumed, yes, this is okay. This quantity is very small, so I don't want to use this. All right. So we are left only with basically the silence. We are left only with major relation because this one is there, this one, this quantity is there, because of this, this will be there. Now we are left with this. We are also assuming in general, in your case you had said anyway, pure bending moment, this is equal to zero. So this also will be zero. So question doesn't arise. But even in the general case, when the pure bending is not there, I am just telling you, this quantity will always be zero. We are assuming again that shear strain 90 degrees always, transverse normals remain straight and normal to the neutral axis all the time. This we are assuming. This is assumption. This is due to Kirchhoff. So therefore, this is always zero. So if this is zero, does it mean this is zero? Yes, zero means this zero. For a shear modulus, given shear modulus, tau has to be 0. But in other load, supposing the load is applied by a cantilever, will there not be a shear force? Shear force has to be this. Where from shear force? Listen to me. Where from shear force come? From the shear stress. The shear stress has to be there in a beam. So shear stress cannot be 0 in general. But shear strain can be 0. Now when that is possible, this is very important. Again, this is very important to understand this. This cannot be 0 in general if it is loaded by some concentrated load or some transverse load is there on the beam. Now, if this cannot be 0, but then you are saying this is 0. You have assumed Kirchhoff assumption is said that gamma xz is always, that means this angle, we are saying x and z. This originally is 90. And even later on when it gets deflected, x becomes slightly inclined and this normal will take, but this 90 degree will be always maintained. That means shear angle between x and z is always 0. This we are assuming. This is to simplify the theory. Now, if you are assuming this, that means this will always be 0. So, when I was young, not only, I did not, let me tell you, I did not realize the importance of this. So I used the Hooke's law and I said this is 0, this is 0. But if this is 0, what about, how will the load be, you know, in a beam like this? If you have a load here, how will this, there has to be a shear force V that is equal to P, and this V comes from integral tau xz dz into B, B is the width of the beam, okay? It has to be there. So this cannot be 0, it has to be, so when, how it is possible? So we will assume that the rigidity G is very, very, please write it, G is very, very high, then it is possible. If G is very high, then this can be 0 and this can be finite. Yes, anything divided by infinity equal to 0. Yes. She is not able to appreciate. Anyway, now anybody else from here, Dhaka, is okay? Any finite quantity divided by a very large quantity will always be close to 0. So shear angle is 0. So we are saying this will exist, but this we are assuming to be that, but I cannot take a physical value of G. That means in a beam theory, G has no, it is a rigid. G infinite means it is a rigid, just like a rock, a stone. It is not an elastic material. It is a, so it implies that. So this. So in a beam, so basically that means we cannot use this relation also. This Hooke's law can also be there, therefore this cannot be used. These two cannot be used. Therefore, we are left with see, I have got a very poor mark in all the account. You know what my friend said, that you have got less than 2.5 out of 5 in all. Average. So that is very poor. 50, less than 55%. So we are left only with this. So we will be making use of this one dimensional. Yes, please. In this case, see, it so happens that in a pure bending it is exact. it is zero, this is also zero, so it is exact. Okay, only in the case of pure bending, it is exact. We are not making any approximation here. Okay, so now this job is done. So Hooke's law we have used to. Still, if you have silence, please. If you have any, try to understand this. It may not be explained in the book in so detail the way I have explained all the consequences of using. But then this is the way things are. Whenever you make any assumption, there will always be some contradiction. So don't think that we are solving a problem exactly. Beam theory is not exact. You will always get approximate solution. We are engineers, so we are happy with some approximation. We want a solution. We want a simple solution, quick solution. If you start doing research for everything, then you are not an engineer. So don't do. So okay. So this is, so Hooke's law is done. Now, can you, now this is the, now I will take the cross section of a beam. This is the depth of the beam. Okay, now take this diagram. So this I have taken, and this is a, at the cross section you have bending moment M. On the other side also M is there. Now M comes, then I want to show, after all this M has to be balanced by the internal stresses. What are the internal stresses? Here you have sigma x. Yes or no? Sigma x has to act. Sigma x. So at this point P, I have taken sigma x. Now, how will this? So this M has to be, so now we are talking of the third step, equilibrium. See, we have made use of deformation, then Hooke's law, and third one is equilibrium. Equilibrium must be maintained at each and every state. These are the three basic principles of mechanics. Every problem must utilize this for the formulation. Three. So third step, so this is M is external. You have applied an external moment M. So this M, you take moment about this M must be, here also there is M. So, but this M comes from the internal. So, what is M external and what is internal? Internal is sigma x will be acting on a small dA. What is dA here? dA. dz into width of the beam. dz into width of the beam. Width is perpendicular in y direction. This is y. Y perpendicular. So dA is the small force. So this is dF multiplied by lever arm. Lever arm means what? Z. integrate from over complete area. So this is one relation, equilibrium. So this is internal force, this is external, and this is internal. Do you agree or not? Because of the stresses, moments are created. Or because once you have applied external moment, that creates stresses. So they must be in balance, they must remain in equilibrium. There cannot be non-equilibrium. Stresses must give you the same moment. So this moment must be equal to this. Other one is, supposing I take simply, I will tell you this. So this is one general relation. Here dA means dz multiplied by b. B is the width of the beam. Width. If it is, let us say, rectangular, width of beam. In a simple problem, dz into b, if the cross section is like this, just like your scale, so here it is, this is b and this is dz. Have you understood? B into dz. Okay. Now other one is, supposing I take simply this, sigma x into dA is small df, and if I integrate this, I don't want moment, I just simply f. So this f, if I integrate throughout the cross section, is there any net force acting in the this beam? No. It's pure bending moment. So if I integrate over the entire area, what it will give? It should be zero. So one relation is this, other one is this. Now, yes, what is x? Since sigma x equal to E times epsilon x into E times, what is that? What is epsilon x in terms of geometry? Z by R. This is there. So substitute it there. So you don't have to see, mechanics is such a subject that you don't have to remember. Of course, some basic steps you must remember. But then operations are all from understanding. So you so we get m equal to integral over area, sigma x will be equal to E into z by r into area dA into z, and 0 is equal to A integral equal to 0. What does this give you? This is 0. normally, what is this? ZDA integral over area divided by total area can we call it something like this? Z bar means distance of centroid from x axis. Is it okay? Z bar is the centroid, location of centroid of the cross section, Z bar. But then this is area is anyway, this is area A. Since this is coming out to be 0, therefore, since integral ZDA equal to 0, x axis is passing through centroid of the cross section. Is it okay? So this is what I have told you, x-axis passes through centroid. So you have got it now, because it is 0. 0 means distance is 0, z bar equal to 0. Z bar 0 means deflections are small. After deflection, stresses are created only after the loads are applied. But then all the geometrical equilibrium you are taking in the undeformed state. Because deflections are small, we are not taking the bent beam for considering equilibrium. We are considering the straight beam for consideration of equilibrium. Why? Because displacements are small. We are using small deflection theory. We are using linear material law. Superposition will hold good here. Okay. So this is all the then all right, so this is, so this one this we have seen that y-axis was dividing the, and this is y, this is z. So this is now, this is g, centroid. X-axis is coming from here. This is x-axis. The x-axis passes through, so our neutral axis, therefore neutral axis passes through centroid so neutral axis will always be aligned through centroid of the cross section. So now you have got a very good relationship that yes, for any cross section align your neutral axis with the centroid. And the plane, horizontal plane which is passing through centroid is called neutral plane, because in the width direction it is not an axis, it is a small plane. Whatever thickness of the beam is there, so it will be small plane like this, which will bend. So that is called neutral plane. All right, now the first one M has given, so this is a good relation. So we can always get. Now, mm-hmm. What is, now take the second relation, take M equal to E by R integral over area of the cross section Z square dA. What is Z square dA is? Of any cross section. Area is there. And this is Z. What is that called? Moment of inertia of the cross section. So this quantity is moment of inertia of the cross section. Is defined, this is a geometrical quantity, moment of inertia. Of cross section, about which axis? Moment of inertia. Yes. About? No. Moment of inertia of cross section. This is the cross section. Y-axis. This is moment of inertia of cross section about y axis. About y axis. This a cross section has moment of inertia about an axis. Now there are two axes for a cross section, Z and Y. X is perpendicular to this. X doesn't appear here. There is no question of. So, either if it is this or this, it is this, because Z square dA, dA is here, Z is this. So, this Z square dA will give you about, so this is Y. So, you get E, IYY, you know, we just call it YY, Y axis, about YY axis, about XX axis, Y axis divided by R equal to M. Now, you have to understand whether it is about y axis. Normally, this subscript is dropped. Y, it is actually y, but subscript is dropped. You have to understand it is always about y axis. So, it is m by I, m by E by R. Yes, please. So this is, we have got a relationship. You can moment. So we have got M by I equal to E by R. R is R related to sigma x? Can you, do you have a relationship R and sigma x? Just check up. Yes. See, R, is R related to sigma x? So now you give me, because I am interested in finding out sigma x. I am not interested in, my main aim was to find out stress in the beam, longitudinal stress in the beam because of moment applied. This was my main aim. So now we have, but we also have, we have sigma x equal to E by R into Z. This relation I had derived earlier, sigma x equal to E times epsilon, epsilon equal to Z by R. So, this relation is already there. And we have got one more relation E by R, and now we have E by R equal to M by I. This is number 2. Therefore, please eliminate E by R, and therefore sigma x will be equal to M by I into Z. This is a very important relationship. Knowing moment on the cross section, moment of inertia of the cross section of a beam, and then Z is the distance from neutral axis to the point, you can find out sigma x. So, given a cross section, moment of inertia is can be computed geometrically for various cross section. Moment is given, you can find out. So, this is famous flexure formula. What is the variation of stress? Just tell me, if this is a depth, this is neutral axis. Yes, what is the variation? How does it vary at any cross section? At any cross section, this is for any cross section. This is valid for any cross section. So, how does it vary? M is constant, I is constant for the cross section, so it varies with Z. So, Z means Z equal to 0, it is 0. Positive Z, it will vary linearly going like this. So, this is how sigma x varies. This is the variation of sigma x. And when Z is negative, so let us say this is h by 2. And this one is what? On the top, it is tensile stress. At the bottom, do you understand or not? When Z negative means this becomes negative, Z negative means you are coming down, you are coming below the neutral axis. Z is being measured positive like this. From this point, here it is Z positive. Here Z will be negative downwards. Z is upwards positive from this point. Here it is negative. So, here it is, these quantities are all negative, this is all positive. So, this is tensile stress. So, bending moment is applied like this. When bending moment is applied like this, this is M. Your stress diagram will be all tensile here, from here to here. And from here to here, it will be compressive. See, this is the way it is drawn. There are so many ways of it. You can also draw it like this. What is the maximum stress? What is sigma maximum? If it is not clear, you let me know. What is the maximum longitudinal stress? Maximum sigma x is how much? M is constant over the cross section, I is constant, the only change that is changing is, so Z maximum plus or minus, whichever Z is, it all depends upon centroid. Z maximum, and Z maximum here is h by 2. Z Z maximum also is, many books it is denoted by MC. C is maximum by I. C is maximum value. C means it is called maximum value of Z. Is it okay? So now you have got a means of finding out its stresses. Its stresses vary linearly through the depth of the beam. Okay? Is it okay? So we will stop here. And attendance.